lovely to see you all.
Hi, Jane.
Thank you all so much for coming to this, the final Visiting Writers Series event of the semester.
Yay!
We're welcoming the poet, Matt Hart, poet, editor, punk rocker, Matt Hart. As always, we want to acknowledge and thank NISCA, which supports this series and allows us to keep bringing excellent writers from around the country to campus to share their work with you. And for those of you who made it to the masterclass earlier today that Matt hosted, I have, and for those of you who didn't and are interested, I have copies of the poetry sermon that Matt delivered, signed. And this other thing that Matt brought out of, you know, like all good educators, over-preparing in case, like, conversation doesn't happen. So this is a selection of poems that speak to the concerns in the sermon, speak to this idea of call and response, right? Is that fair?
Yeah.
So these are available after the reading tonight, so come get me if you'd like them. The other things that I'm going to just sort of wave at you for the time being are over here.
We have,
for tonight, yet another wild broadside done by Rich Kager at the Book Art Center. This is, right?
So cool.
I love holding these up and just looking out and seeing, like, Athens, like, that's awesome. Like, it really is, right? Rich very much got into the spirit of Matt's book and designed this around the idea of, like, beautiful noise and, like, the space, the connective tissue between noise and music, and it radiates. It was a thing he sent an image of this to me to proof, and I was like, how do I proof this? It's a mess, but it's a glorious mess, and I think it looks great. Everything that isn't correct seems expressively and wonderfully wild. Also, how did you get it crooked? Because I don't understand this much about book arts. And he should have sent me a picture of how he did it. It involves, like, thin wedges of wood and really crazy complex maneuvers to try to get it to fan out and radiate in this way. So this will be available in the future online, as always, for $25, but tonight it is available for $10 for everyone here. And Matt has also brought his Come Get Me Again. The only other thing on my agenda now is to introduce Matt Hart and get the hell out of the way. So what do I say about Matt? One of my favorite reviews of Matt Hart's works was in several sections, and one section begins, "Who are the poets of happiness? Surely Matt Hart is one of them." And then goes on to describe how much easier it is to write from a position of, like, poetic ache. But that is not what Matt Hart does. He's an exuberant poet, a joyful poet, a poet who fills his books with the people and things that he loves, and that love is palpable and infectious and delightful. And I first encountered Matt through his poems, which I loved immediately. And you always have this anxiety when you love a poet's work, where you're thinking, I don't want to meet this person because I really like the version of them that I have now. And what if they suck? Ouch. And Matt, as a human, is very much like the Matt that you encounter in these pages. And that is to say, delightful, energetic, wild and charming and fun and such a treat to be around and a friend and someone who, when I think about the best of the poetry community, this very strange small world that I am excited to be a part of, his name is on the top of the list of people who I think make that community a better place. So I was thrilled to invite him here. I'm thrilled to have him share. share his work with you, and so please welcome Matt Hart.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Wells and Dan. I'm like super excited. So I'm going to read some poems from these two collections that came out simultaneously. Actually, they're not two collections. Radiant Action is a single long poem which sort of meditates on the power of poetry to be a positive force between people that can connect people viscerally and literally. And I talked a lot about that today in my sermon, so if you want to hear more about it, you can grab that at the end. Radiant Companion is a collection of poems which takes some of that same meditation that's in the long poem and spins it out toward particular other people, my radiant companions, of course. It's also the radiant companion to the long poem. So I'll start with a section from Radiant Action. If you must, you must. Open your mouth, let the light roll out, ping pong with books, fire, 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 blinding lake water, weird sisters, blood brothers, dumb green hands. Come one, come all, to the wind-up spirit. The time unfolds with fists that shake, lips that burst. The light is mine, it rolls along. The love is mine, too, is also mine. The Clash records and the skateboards, the devil beside me, the meadow beside me, the heavy water alphabet, the neighborhood yay-sayers of Cincinnati, all my friends' poems, and my wife on arrival in the driveway after work, so bewildered and beautiful, while I sit disheveled and think about tomorrow, this porch on this porch. The world's skull is mine, the hoped-up, hoped-for future is mine, the vanishment, the robots. But what's more, I belong to all of it. We are all of us inseparable from creation and destruction, the floodlight of darkness we emit in this life. Moreover, the forces we attract, catch, miss. How do we position ourselves to be our best? How do we make all this hell into a heaven, intractable heaven, awash in the glare, gorgeous glare of it? Oh, happy new breath, not blood, not hornets, not venom, not sonnet. I'm asking the questions because I want to need the answers. I wake up screaming my whole throat to red. Today is the day I'll attempt to make sense. My dumb green heart is wide open. Woo! Wow. So when I started writing these books, my daughter Agnes was 5. She's 11 now. And actually, I got the phrase radiant action while reading Charlotte's Web to her. I'd never read Charlotte's Web when I was a kid, like most sane people. So I was glad to read it as an adult, and there's a point you'll remember in the book, probably, that Charlotte the Spider sends Templeton the Barnyard Rat out to get more text so that she can write it in her web and save Wilbur the Pig from being slaughtered. And Templeton goes out with a bad attitude and comes back with an advertisement for laundry detergent, which says something like, and now with even more new Radiant Action. And I remember when I read it, I said to Agnes, I was like, Radiant Action, that's such a great phrase. And she's like, yeah, it's okay. But I kept thinking about it, and I kept thinking about it in relation to the artistic process and the practice of what artists do and the ways that the words that we use, the materials that we use, the compositions that we make go out into the world, and you never know what they're going to hit. You never know who they're going to change. And I know this from my own experience because I have been changed by those things. So that's a lot about that's more in depth about how these books kind of work and come together. But all that to say, I'm going to read this poem called Reaching the Awe Sound, which has Agnes in it. She only likes the poems at my readings now that she's in. The rest of the time, she's like looking at a device. But... Reaching the awe sound. Here and now, this blue winter sky, and outside a light frost, the windows of the houses and the windows of the cars. I walk out on the porch and my glasses fog up. I start my engine to make things warm. Voices swirl around as a white-muzzled dog trots by in this marvel of everything good morning. Back inside with the radio on, the word in the air is terrorist suspects. Videos of child soldiers executing spies. I wrestle the juice from an orange in my mouth. I read the beginning of Song of Myself, the price of petroleum, a coming election. Stepped on spear of dead winter grass. I do not loaf. I lean on the counter and call for my daughter. She puts her small self in a puffy blue coat. I put my small self in a black wool sweater. I drive her to school with the radio off. She spells words with the awe sound in them. Awesome, outlaw, walrus, autumn, divides by nines from 108. At the drop-off spot, she gets out of the car. I love you, I say. I'll be back to pick you up. And when she shuts the door, I turn the radio on, and then I turn it back off. At home, Greek yogurt with pistachios and pecans, a little honey. I drink life down to a hot cup of coffee, this soft dailiness, my ordinary yawp and drawer and author and oft. This picture of heaven where there isn't any heaven is as good a place as any to begin to make a heaven. Either we give ourselves to a course of action or we do not give ourselves, wrote William Carlos Williams. The rest of the day, I am mostly messed up. I go on my nerve. I celebrate myself. I burn through the world with my hands held out. Heaven with the radio off. I was going to say, I know there's a Q&A kind of part of this at the end, but you can interrupt me at any time if you have anything to say or you have questions. I mean, maybe not in the middle of a poem, but in between poems, you can feel free to just jump in. I studied philosophy in college, and then I went to graduate school for philosophy. I studied the later philosophy of Ludwig Wittgenstein, which has been actually really important to me in my poetry. There's a point in the second half of the Philosophical Investigations, which is his later philosophy, where he says, if a lion could speak, we couldn't understand him. And the idea roughly is that a lion's forms of life are so wildly different than ours that even if a lion could speak English, it wouldn't be English that would make any sense to us. So this is called Philosophical Investigations. The lion says a bunch of weird, perplexing things about the world. That he's a lion doesn't really matter, but he hopes some of you will know his heart from what comes next. Furthermore, that he's a king of the jungle isn't necessary, which is different than saying it doesn't matter. What's necessary is logically necessary, or it's logically unnecessary, that is all. So he roars and roars a bunch of enigmatic, technical things about the world, and about its being a bunch of facts, not things, or about its being mostly of words in some pianist's throat, or not. The possibility of negation of any fact is embedded in the totality of facts as they present themselves, but neither the totality nor the possibility are part of what the lion says, though what he does say shows them in perfect relief. The chaos of the soul softly rises, he sings. His singing is anomalous and sounds like polished oyster shells, paradise found and unmoored from what's found, goodness and beauty, mercy and grace. But philosophy cannot say such things, the lion knows. Logically or sensibly, with feeling, nor accurately, scientifically, with verve at little cost. One can't say feeling, one can only express it rarely, my dear, or falsely, my love, or a moth settles onto my window ledge lost, light spilling in on the book the lion wrote. Nothing is certain, but it seems someone has leaned a ladder up against the house we don't share together anymore, or much. Yes, I'm here. I've always been here. I am not very far. I climb into the canopy of trees, and when I reach through their green, a hippopotamus is in the room, or a hippopotamus is not in the room. As always, this is true. And all the light that ever warmed me is fading. Rather mystically, it's blue, fading into mountain sea, with glitter gloss and lionry and silence. Is everybody okay?
Yeah.
So, this is going to get loud.
Can I ask a question? So when you're writing these poems, you have such a lively and incredible voice, right? When you're writing them, do you think about what it will sound like when you read them, or are you just writing it for the page and only the page?
I'm writing it for the page when I'm writing them, and I hear them in my head very differently than I perform them. The voice that I hear them in my head is pretty quiet and steady and lost. I've often said that it would be really fun to do a reading tour where I went to 50 states, 50 cities, and the reading would be for 50 people, and I would get each reading right up against one person's head as quietly as possible. But, you know, I have a background playing in punk rock bands, and I always want poetry readings to be more like punk rock shows than poetry readings, because poetry readings can be dreadful. And when you're in a room and you're in front of an audience, there is an opportunity to allow the poem to be something that it's not on the page. So I think about the poems in the air and the poems on the page as entirely different animals. So yeah, I'm writing them for the page. I mean, obviously, like, I pay attention to the music of the words, and I'm always playing with sounds. And the poet Kenneth Koch often said that when I'm writing, I'm hearing two things. I'm hearing what the words say, and also how they sound. And often I let the sounds carry me along to whatever the poem wants to be. And I often say that I let the sounds carry me along to the things that are on my mind that I had no idea were on my mind, if I'm lucky. So yeah, that's the short, long answer. Sure. So there's a punk rock band called Jawbreaker that was really, really important to me growing up. They have a song called Ache on a great album called 24 Hour Revenge Therapy. And the beginning of that song, the first line of the song is, "I believe in desperate acts, the kind that make me look stupid." And I have taken that as a mantra in my art life. And in my life as much as possible too, because I feel like if you're only ever doing things that you sort of know will work, if you're only ever doing things that you're totally comfortable doing, you're probably gonna have a pretty hard time innovating. Getting outside of the things that you already know comfortably how to do. So they've been really important to me. This poem I'm going to read references Jawbreaker, and also Coleridge and Wordsworth, references Jawbreaker, not that song in particular, it references another song. But don't worry, this is all part of the act. It's called Poem with a Chorus by Jawbreaker. The word is pain. and the world is pain, but the sun on our skin is enormous and light. I went out running this morning the way I always do, awkwardly with lightning. And at some point, I thought about the song Chesterfield King by Jawbreaker, which is a punk rock conversation poem in the romantic tradition, if ever one existed after Coleridge and Wordsworth made it a thing, then abandoned it. The chorus goes, I took my car and drove it down the hill by your house. I drove so fast. But when it couldn't cool me down, I turned it around and came back up. You were waiting on your step, still showing off your breath and water in your eyes. We pull each other into one, pockets clinging on the lawn, and kissed right there. The stanza breaks are mine. I don't know why I thought about that then, or why I'm thinking about it now, except that it's a song you should know if you don't already. It has a fragility to it, a vulnerability in its lion-flaming punk rock heart that reminds me of your poems and how longing never leaves us as long as we live, which is lucky and even better. I'm suddenly struck by the image of a rowboat on the sunset horizon with one lonely figure rowing into the distance out to sea. And in this image, which is really the world, I'd like to call out to the figure in the boat, to the him or the her, who's probably you or me, or someone just like us, someone in need, but they're too far away to hear me, or I'm too far away to hear me, and yet that doesn't mean I shouldn't scream and scream to try and get their attention, because attention connects us and generates possibilities, and possibilities are the stitches that we use to close the wounds, the ones that we inflict, and the ones inflicted on us. Yeah, the world is pain, but attention is rich, and connection changes everything when we allow it to sing us. The sun going down, so light and enormous, the pink and orange waves, their marvelous chorus. I took my car and drove it down the hill by your house. I drove so fast. You took your boat and rowed it out, both to listen and mend. I'm standing here hoping to get your attention. Longing for its own sake is a letter close to heaven. Longing and words continue the world.
Okay. What was the name of that album?
I'm sorry?
What was the name of that album?
The album that the song is from? It was on an album called Bivouac. Yeah. And the song is called Chesterfield King.
What was the other album?
The one that's got the great line in it, I believe in desperate acts, the kind that make me look stupid, is called 24-Hour Revenge Therapy. There's a really strong sense in which I think of reading as writing. That when I'm reading, I'm also writing. The things I read are always fuel for the fire, also the conversations that I have, the questions people ask me. Everything ends up in the poems. Everything I'm paying attention to ends up in the poems. And part of the reason for that is that I'm not a poet who intends things, I'm a poet who attends to things. The poems are constellations of attention. And I gather about me the community of people and books and records and things that I love, because that's actually a lot harder than the opposite, which is pushing all that stuff away. You know, it's sort of easy to hate stuff. It's easy to push things away. I said this today in my talk, which is like, it's easy to push things away. It's hard to love things. And the reason that it's hard to love things is because you have to move the furniture of your life around to let them in. Like, you have to make room for this new thing or this thing in your life. And the poems, you know, there's a sense in which, I've never really thought about it this way before, but there's a sense in which the poems are a way of moving the furniture of life around to make sense of experience and to build these structures in which I and hopefully other people can feel at home. And so, why not quote people? Just brings them close. The difference between noise and meaningful noise. The difference between noise and what's meaningful. And the flat sameness of it all. Generation to generation, disruption to eruption. I pay better attention when I'm distracted from the thesis than when I'm distracted from expression. I have to work harder, this life on the road, this ear to an audience, the ductwork, the basement, the furnace, the stairs. I wonder if you've ever stared at a geranium petal and seen all the pain leaking into the world. It doesn't make any sense at first, or maybe ever, but blood is being spilled. People are alone. Some of them are even happy about it, but some of them are lost and wanting something. Some of them are giving. Some of them have been taken from their homes, whole families, lost tree limbs when the wind sets its jaw. I worry that my worry is too decorative. That the blue-green wallpaper is itself the only wall, that the hands clasped together and the deference shown is only for show. How many times have I wrecked my only day off in a week in the image of the anger and sadness all around it, the silence between me and myself and my other, my mother, my father, my sister, my brother, the awkward stubbornness, the half-baked plans to make it better. Last night, I paddled a boat around a lake, which isn't true, but sounds more romantic than what really took place. And I looked at all the houses in a circle around it, the lemon yellow ones, the moss blue green ones, even pink ones, and one with big red hearts in relief on its gutters. I don't know why the looking matters or why I liked seeing them, but I did. Some of them are huge places, and some of them are barely shacks. One was recently in a fire. From the look of it, I imagine it'll have to be torn down, all smoke black and gutted. But does the lie that I told and then admitted to telling about paddling the boat around the lake make a difference? I was actually in a boat, but the boat had an engine, going around in a circle with my family several miles. It's a prettier circle without the engine, don't you think? A lonelier circle and more idyllic without the family. So, let's see. Okay, we're doing all right. I teach at an art college in Cincinnati called the Art Academy of Cincinnati. So, and we just got a BFA in creative writing this year, but up until this year, all my students have been purely sort of visual artists, but they all have a real interest in writing because they love the idea of language as a kind of material artistic medium that they can use for their own purposes. And I teach a class at school sometimes called Giant Books. And in it, we read giant books. books that are like really large and long, but also books that cover a large amount of territory or that have a sort of conceptual largesse to them somehow. And I taught Moby Dick a few years ago, and this references that. It also references a time a few years ago when I was in New Orleans doing a conference with Dan. So this is called Immediate Neighbors. At a final cruising altitude of 36,000 feet, I'm thinking about the chapter called The Pipe in Moby Dick, and also about my student Sam, who memorized it in her fingers by typing it 136 times, once for each of the chapters in the book plus the epilogue, and then performed it for the class, swaying back and forth, ghost typing the air to remember the words, so that Ahab's human struggle became her own human struggle, and all of us in tears as we stood there with our wonder. Tough and shocking, a fragile new meaning. But what triggered this memory, I don't know. Flying, maybe. In the air, next to clouds, or this young woman about the same age as Sam sitting beside me and who's coincidentally also named Samantha but goes by Sammy, not Sam, she tells me. She's never seen clouds this close before, having never flown in an airplane before, so she's taking pictures and can't stop chattering, popping bubblegum, shuffling her notes for chemistry. She's a chemistry major in Minnesota, she tells me, among other things. And through it all, barely listening, I'm remembering, and also some forgetting. I can't remember my first time flying, but right now I'm flying, so that's something. If I could only be sweeter and meaner, more voluminous, it occurs to me I could rise and then fall and then rise like Ziggy Stardust and the spiders from Mars. And then if I could write down some chemical equations, maybe take a few of you with me to Paradise Found or Negative Capability, I would love that to pieces the way I love any linguistic associations. Connotation to constellation in a few leaps and bounds. The problem of the poem is to experience its ending, having already known so beautifully its beginning, by which I mean an agony of life and deathery of music and speech, which is given for a minute and taken away. The pipe thrown overboard and lost at sea. Sam's air typewriter, her struggle to remember, and this other Samantha, Sammy, she reminds me, her carrot juice hair and serious green eyes, taking pictures of a plane from the window of a plane. The last 3 days in New Orleans, I've been a version of sparrows and radioactivity. And now on my way home to Cincinnati, the Samantha beside me radiates light, so radiates being. People only call me Sammy when I'm drunk. My student Sam once said to me, drunk, then nearly got arrested driving home to write a poem. And suddenly, I'm vividly aware of all the secrets sitting near me, rising and falling, maybe rising against me, and I want to know every one of them. And also, I wonder if Sam would be okay with this poem. I mean, the part about her nearly getting arrested is not really my story to tell, or is it? She was drunk, I called her Sammy, it all could have ended horribly, but great fortune that it didn't. Sam's totally brilliant and deserves the world's attention, the world's massive love, wherever she can get it, but she's had a rough time by anybody's measure. Dear Sam, you've beaten the odds, you're winning, be happy, don't throw yourself in the drink of any ocean, keep swaying the breeze, ghost typing your songs. As for the title of this poem, Immediate Neighbors, well, I stole it while sneaking a look at Sammy's quantum chemistry notes, something having to do with particles and the sharing of electrons, but what do I know? I just read giant books and lift off. Chemistry's a total mystery to me. The mystery in chemistry, coffee, beer, and ibuprofen. I steal everything the best way I can, I suppose, from all my friends and neighbors, the immediate ones and some distant planets. And with that, we've begun our initial descent. Current weather in Cincinnati is clear skies with gusty winds out of the northwest at 10 miles per hour. We should be getting to the gate just a little ahead of schedule and on the ground in about 15 minutes. On behalf of both myself and the Samanthas, thanks for flying with us. Flight attendants, prepare the cabin. So we have begun our initial descent. And I want to end with this poem that I was telling Dan about earlier today, which is new. I'm going to try to read it. It started as a translation of Guillaume Apollinaire's great poem, Zone, which was a poem that was celebrating the sort of end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century. He was really enamored with things like airplanes and collage. And I don't speak or read French, so I can't really do a translation of the poem. So what I did is an obliteration of the poem. I used a French dictionary, and I used Google Translate to get a basic, rough English translation, and then I destroyed it. So my version of this poem is called End Zone, like the end zone on a football field. Typically, the first line of this poem in English is translated as something like, you're tired of this old world at last. End zone. That old thing? No wonder you're tired. Great tower with its grimace, standing guard among the sheep. Punk rock music's not enough anymore. Not even rocket ships smell like antiques. Heaven's fallen mothfish are the only ones left, dragged coast to coast in fisherman's net. Spreading their wings, we get a whiff of dark moss. We name it the internet and nod while it chugs, cumulonimbus puffs of regret. To come clean in a new age of numbers, this is physics. Hostage as we are to a wilderness of messages, no one seems able to agree when they're true. You can hippopotamus yourself on plastic and rubber, but very little which is new isn't noise under the sun. This morning, on a search for I wasn't sure what, I immersed myself in a story I've now forgotten, and a better than average piece of avocado toast, which I remember with a fondness. Business geeks, the craft beer set, and daffodils colluding with snakes, moment to moment in front of my face, they skedaddle. On Wednesdays, the drains and the sirens get tested. At noon in the sky, a throbbing jet engine, graffiti on garage doors, advertisements wailing, consume and belong. So much is the noise I love, the den of search engines, the MGM Lions Club. In Westwood, where I live, it could be anywhere, really. Between Northside and Price Hill, the streets are all the same ones you remember from your childhood. You and your mom in the satellite convulsions. You and your old friends, Eric, Pete, and Lung, trying new blurs in a haze you call feedback. It is 9 o'clock and the music's only starting, but you managed to absent yourself from your once sputtery, now worse for wear homes. You scream it all night in a digital gibberish, artificially intelligent, it goes on forever, tells you who to blame. The marvel of screen light that keeps you awake. It is a tendril, which is everybody's fault. It is a roof against the meadow with a laser-guided bullet. It is a motherless child made of infinite funhouse. It is a wall of have you seen me, please call, chat room post-it notes. It is two black holes embracing an artist who will always be nameless. It is a sidewise face made only of punctuation. It is that we are in soul or squiggles or made to look just like it. It is the speed of the invisible connection made flesh-ish, a main-gendered particle that enters an iris. It teaches us daily how to serve it, the 21st century. Curlicue of meat food, transformed via splicing of a robot with a hawk, tearing through space where the planets are lonely, the pit-headed quarks lift their faces in awe, imitating politicians who pray against money. They motion with their mouths that we should name it forever. Creatures with propellers hover over in wonder. Teletubbies, G.I. Joe, effigy of Donald Trump, they splinter to hell, which is only our Earth, connecting mid-air in the glass on the gloss of virtual of reality staged and sprayed on. The executives giggle and brush the puppets off. They're tired of prepositions, but what other way is there to achieve our objective? The atmosphere flashes with computer screen spume. The sentences circle each other. The words for birds, idiotic idioms, an ICBM dawdles overhead. The new Mythmaster, and painted on the side of it, Thomas Jefferson's chin. The anxiety and energy settle nothing over everything. The people in the street transfixed in its glow, a swarm with heavy feelings. Then someone makes a less expensive version. Someone else makes one the size of a peanut. Another appears later disguised as a duck with the head bitten off by a hairdresser. But then the head regenerates itself, and it's an even better head of hair. One with a mind for complicated math, astonishing knife work, the makeshift gymnasium triage of goats. They testify before Congress with rags in their throats, everybody swirling around the light of a phone, happy to be absorbed in its lithium amusements. Now you sprint quick where your GPS sends you. Crowds of faces in the blackberry bushes. Your body contracts with love and awe. You wonder that any love still exists that you can hold. If you were your grandfather's, you'd be a salesman or a machinist, haunted by the thought of it and that you think it beneath you. You beat yourself up with Wellbutrin and beer, a courtyard of static electricity and coughs. The little eels inside you spill out when you look. If it's anything at all, it's contemporary art, a pop-up shop where you go to feel close. But find it, sorry, we're closed. You walk through Cincinnati and the wounds, which are daisies, past tense, is not a necessary consideration now that awkwardness is sublimity. Waiting in line at the West Side Brewery, the West Side Town Hall is visible through the window. The bells of St. Francis bleed into the squirrels. I am ill with congratulations, the joy in my veins. I would give you if I could, but the picture Marianne took of me and my dog only causes you anguish. I am always against your cheek, dauntless and raw with almonds and collations. Now on the banks of the Ohio River, your backpack's full of lemons, one for every month to put in your mouth. You have friends in your updo, one from Brooklyn, one from Oakland, and two from just over there. All of us afraid for the temperatures and weather, the new ransomware viruses of technological advancement. You find yourself in an undisclosed location. It pleases you to no end, your tattoo of a rhinoceros, the very last one. But rather than words coming out of your mouth, you hear the faint signals of the beauty of equations, like a worm inside a worm in a saint's brain of old. Bewildered, you find yourself in kaleidoscopic neighborhoods unknown. You see yourself fractured in the autumnal blush, your Joe Strummer rearranged into starlight, the trucks on the street all driving in reverse. You feel yourself becoming history, climbing up the water tower. You and your compadres are already drunk. Hello, you call from Michigan among the cherries and asparagus. Hello, you post an image from inside the Death Star. Hello, you say from Brooklyn in heavy metal Japanese. Look at me. You tell every one of your friends at once. I'm in San Francisco with an oyster which is the love of my life with horseradish. You always need a warm bed to sleep off the dream. I too need such a bed full of toast crumbs and butter. But then you wake up in the wrong place at the wrong time in the back of a police car headed to the station. Your lives of the mosquitoes is a cloud in your mouth, an indication that you've been tricked by the fox in a gabardine suit, disassembled by affection many times in your life. I realize I've been garish as a dolphin in the dirt. You can't look at your body in the snow getting old, and that's why I sob like an ice cream truck mechanic. It's for you and your beloved that I give my own to wolves. Staying with sadness, you consider the nervous systems, which are not your nervous systems. They think a higher power electrifies their glow. They smell like hospitals orbiting other planets. They read Kierkegaard to their children. They want to swallow all the watches and proclaim themselves rich, show up at the houses of their parents and gut them. One weary family carries passwords in the rain, buckets and blankets which dream without wonder. So many of them want to make themselves useful. They are not picky, doing any work they can. Often I have watched them breathing air in the park. Some people object to their spirits playing chess. They come from the far reaches of the gnarled arms of God. Nothing is scratched in the glass of their perfection. You loiter with your face in the beer nuts. You sip a cold coffee with moss in the grasses. When it gets dark, you wrap fish in some corn husks to steam for your dinner. Your blood brothers and weird sisters are not evil, only anxious. Every single one of them having made it with pain. One is the child of a cop in New Jersey. I have no idea if her hands consist of sugar. My gargantuan sympathies knead her like dough. I make myself lowly before anyone who's damaged, anyone who's broken or joyous, uncommitted. You are without company as the dawn rises up. The garbage men rattle the cans in the streets. The darkness dissolves like a howl on a leash. The darkness which is false, so you wait while it passes. The airplane bourbon cries, which is why you always drink it. You drink it like a life of perfume burning sweet. You amble through the city and never think of getting a cab. You want to sleep among your neighbors and all their dear complaints. Every one of them just like you, of different tinted pixels. They are your betters, Illuminati revelers, movie stars of silent breath. So long, so long, so long, and now goodbye, into the hatcheted neck of the sun.
I've read the Marianne Cause, the Roger Shattuck, the Donald Lavelle. Yeah, yeah. Rod Paget has a new one that came out last year, which sadly I don't love as much as I would have liked. But yeah, I've read lots of them in translation. Yeah.
No. I was just getting into punk. It's something that's new to me. I grew up with like pretty much everything rock except for that came out of the Navy during the 80s.
Yeah, have you read This Band Could Be Your Life? Michael Azarod. It's called Our Band Could Be Your Life. Our Band Could Be Your Life, Michael Azarod. This Band Could Be Your Life is a lyric from a Minuteman song that he appropriated for the title of his book. But it's called Our Band Could Be Your Life. Michael Azarod's great history of punk. I almost hate to suggest this, but it is a really good history of sort of the early punk rock scene, which was pretty violent sometimes, but it's called Please Kill Me. I can't remember who wrote that book.
Yeah, my dad
recommended
Suicidal Tendencies.
Yeah, I mean, Suicidal Tendencies is like a, you know, they're punk. They came about right at the time when punk and metal started to like mix together. So it's real metal-y, but like I love The Clash, I love Jawbreaker. The very first punk records I ever heard were the Dead Kennedys Plastic Surgery Disasters and Black Flags Damaged, which I still think are great records. But we can talk more, I can give you more recommendations later. Yeah, I can write them down for you. Yeah.
Your poems read so much like kind of free writing thoughts, just like putting them down as you go. How much do you revise them?
A lot. A lot. I mean, when I put them, they're not nearly as musical when I put them down. I mean, I'm listening for that when I'm writing, but like I'm not capable of like making them do that. The other thing is, you know, I don't, to me, the poems, they're not channel surfing. The poems aren't like, there is a thread there. It's hard to hear reading sometimes because it's all like going by at warp speed, right? But it's there, the thread is always there, and I'm always trying to bring it back around somehow at the end. That's super important to me. So when I'm revising, I'm also thinking about how can I make this make some kind of a circle, or how can I make this add up to something more than the sum of its parts? The way, you know, a collage, right, is a composition of fragments, but a collage that works is one that somehow amounts to more than the sum of its parts in the end, that radiates rather than delineates meaning. And so I'm always thinking about that, ways of like creating these threads through the poem that are actually sort of followable, either in terms of association or connotation or sound or idea to idea to idea, to make these kind of constellations in the work. So I revise a ton. I have written a poem, you know, I said today, every single day of 2017, and I put them face down on a pile on my desk, and I'm not allowed to look at any of them until 2018. So today was number 329, I think. And I've been typing them. I have a Remington Portable number 7 at home, and I type on that because I can't revise as I go. I can't kill the poem before it's anything the way I do on a word processor. But when I'm already thinking about January 1st, you know, the years, like, and I'm gonna have this, I've got this giant stack of poems, and then what? Like, what am I gonna do? I can't possibly, like, revise all of them. I mean, I guess I could, it'd take me a lifetime. It's, like, unbelievable. But I'm, like, really enjoying the process of writing. Like, just, you know, for the first time in 20 years or more, I don't have any poems to send anywhere. And I don't care. I'm loving writing poems.
But Matt, what did you do earlier years then? If this is the first year you've not looked at them, or is that what you do every year?
No, this is the first time I've ever done this. I've given myself weird prompts before where I've had to write like 25 poems in a weekend or something, but I've never written a poem every single day for a year and not looked at them. Because that's the other thing, it's like when I write something, I'm excited about it. I want to work on it, like right away. And I can't. I haven't. So it'll be interesting to see if I can even get back to you know, some of where I was. And at this point, things that I was excited about in February, I don't even remember. Yeah. So I don't. It's going to be like a, you know, opening up somebody else's writing from a year and looking at it, and seeing what's there. It's going to be super. You had a question in the back. Yeah.
I don't know if it's kind of a half-way question. So maybe you can help me. Maybe I'll just like throw words at you and you can help me with that. Okay, so say you're driving along or you're living your life and you see something and you're like, I need to put that in a poem, because that's kind of, I don't know, I feel like there's a lot of those things, put in your poems. Do you think what's more important, you getting that into the poem or the quality in which it's produced? I know that the poem doesn't help.
I don't know if I would make a distinction between those two things.
Yeah, I don't like.
I thought where you were going with this was like, you know, do you like stop what you're doing and like, you know, take the picture,
yeah,
you know, and like write it down so that you have it to put in a poem later. But it's like, you see something and it strikes you and like later you sit down. I mean, here's the thing, I don't think I ever in my life go, I'm gonna put that in a poem.
Yeah.
Never.
Cool.
Never.
That's even more interesting.
I try to pay attention to everything around me.
Yeah.
And I try as much as possible to pay attention to things that I feel like other people aren't paying attention to. And I let those things filter through me in the ways that they do. And then when I sit down to write and I start writing, because I never know where I'm gonna go, I don't know what I'm gonna do, those things come to the surface again and they end up in the poem or they don't. I try really hard to like be present in the moment.
Yeah.
And to like live in that present moment and to, and here's the other thing too, is that I don't think about my life and my poems as being separate things. They're the same thing. And so the idea, like right now, I am putting this in my poems. And so so it's like all of it gets filtered in, you know? Like your question might like wind up in a poem. Because I'll go home later and I'll think like, I gave her a really stupid answer. That was dumb. Like, why did I say those things? And then, you know, I'll be writing about that.
No, this is great.
So, yeah.
Thank you. Sure. That
was a good question. Did you have another question, Kate?
Yeah. So, like, the whole punk rock lifestyle slash, like, being, like, this raw, wild, empathetic creature, two very not careful things, right? And they're kind of reckless and they're really hard. But, like, your poetry is so careful in terms of, like, you're so precise and exact. Even your imagery, you know, like, pistachios and Greek yogurt with honey, like, yeah, and the radio. Like, I don't know, it's wonderful. But how do you balance that? That's something I've been, wrestling with a lot. It's, like, how to be careful in the work and then not exactly be careful all the time. Like, do you, like, feel like with what you're doing, there's, like, carefulness and intention in that?
Yeah,
or,
so...
like, do you have to have that to write the carefulness?
So I'm going to answer your paradox with a paradox.
Great.
Which is, you can't be in control out of control.
Right.
But as an artist, you have to be.
Right.
A bad artist not to be. You can't be out of control in control. I think, so the way punk rock ties into this for me is that part of what I was drawn to in punk rock was the fact that, like, the best punk rock felt like it could fall apart at any second. That it wasn't perfect, it wasn't well produced. Sometimes the people who were making it couldn't play, sometimes they couldn't sing, but they were willing to throw themselves against the wall to express the things they wanted to express in the ways that they wanted to express it, and it held together or it didn't. And so when you listen to a band like The Germs, who were a wreck and couldn't play anything. Nevertheless, those songs in their herky-jerky way hold together and still hold up today as totally amazing because somehow they achieve that balance of total recklessness and calm in the storm at the same time. And the other thing I'll say is that, like, I feel that a lot of shows that I've been to where I've seen bands that, like, really do the thing that I aspire to do and can't do in poems somehow. You know, it's like when you see these bands play, they play as if it might very well possibly be the last show they ever do. That they might literally die. And I'm always like, man, that's amazing. Like, how do you do that? And do it, you know, night after night. I mean, there's a band called Pianos Become the Teeth. Has anybody heard of that band? So the lead singer for that band is a total screamer. And he screams in a way that you literally, it's almost like you can hear his vocal cords bang against his neck. And it always sounds like every song he sings will be the last song he ever sings because he will not be able to make another sound. And there's something really powerful and dangerous about that and reckless about that. But in a poetic context, if you can find a way to be in the writing, not in your life, I'm not suggesting anybody do anything crazy in their life, in the writing, if you can find a way to do that, right, you can do something really amazing. And if you fail, the only thing that happens is that you wrote a shitty poem today. Nobody dies. And tomorrow you can write another poem. And you can try again. And you didn't ruin your voice. Yeah, well, what I mean is, like, I'm not in my life, like, actively trying to destroy myself.
Right.
You know? Like, I've played in punk rock bands for 35 years. I was never into drugs. Mm-hmm. I was around a lot of people who did drugs. But I was never into drugs. I didn't even take a drink of alcohol until I was 22. You know, I
I was generally like in my life pretty careful, but in the things that I've done artistically, I've always wanted to find a way around that. And also I think in my relationships with people, I try as much as possible to be open and reckless in a giving, empathetic way, which is dangerous too.
It hurts, yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe this is tied to that same question, which is like you describe the poems as sort of part of your lived experience, and like almost a document of the lived experience in a way, right? And the thing about that is that there are other people in there, and this came up sort of palpably in the Sam and Sam section of that poem. How's Sam gonna feel about me telling this story that's maybe her story to tell? And like, you know, Sam read this book.
Yeah.
Like, how did you negotiate that ethical space of like, you're bringing your entire world into your work,
right. But
your world includes other people?
Yeah, I showed that poem to her first, of course. Like, she was the first person I showed it to.
Yeah.
You know, as far as telling secrets goes, that's pretty.
Yeah, that's
not that big of a deal. There are things that I actually have not written about yet because I can't. Because I think it would be they're not things that in some ways I'm ready to deal with, and they're also not things that I could write without being hurtful to someone. And I'm not going to do that. There are things, you know, there are things I could write about my family that I'm not prepared to do. And you know, I think it's weird because I want to be as open and reckless as possible, but I also I want to do that with regard to like my life. And my work. I don't want to wreck anybody else. Like, I'm not, you know, poetry is so much about joy and celebration for me, I don't want to hurt anybody. So, I mean, if I had a poem like that, that brought up something that I was even remotely worried about, I would show it to the person first and say, what do you think about this? And if they were like, ugh, I'd be like, okay, well, it's cool, I'll put that one away, you know?
Very different type of book, but Sharon Olds, maybe 2 books ago, finally released a book that she had written maybe, I forget, 10, 20 years prior,
but
she didn't send it out into the world until her children had grown up enough to not be hurt by what she had to say about their dad, you know?
Right, sure.
It's such a complicated space, but and like Agnes, like as someone whose child, who's much younger than your child, is cropping up in my poems all the time.
Yeah.
I think about like, he can't really tell me if he's cool with that or not.
Yeah.
But you said Agnes, just like the only poem she likes is the ones that
she just in. Wants to be mentioned in all the poems. Yeah. That's like her, that's her thing. But I also think like, you know, I spend a lot of time trying to accentuate the positive and be hopeful and be with people that I love, and so, you know, in some ways it's the actual particulars that come up in the poems most of the time are not, they're not problematic. What's problematic is me sitting back and thinking about those particulars and how they might not be, or the potential absence of those particulars at some point, or the potential absence of me, I mean, the actual definite absence of me at some point, or the absence of those people, or, you know, the fact that, like, I am very lucky and privileged to have a lot of great things and great people and great experiences around me, and I know that most of the people on this planet don't have that. They don't have anything
don't have any freaking time for poetry. If you have time for poetry, you have more time than you need and more time than you deserve. You know? And so, like, what, I mean, how do we deal with that? I mean, that's where the darkness comes up in the poems. You know, I want to cry, like, thinking about that, but, like, yes. Okay, so the second question, so I've played in bands for 35 years and I've written many songs, and in fact, I was saying earlier today that, like, my experience with poetry in high school was pretty negative. You know, I had teachers who asked me to read things by people from centuries ago that I had a hard time relating to, but then I would still read them and I would try to talk about them and the teacher would say, no, you're wrong. So I didn't really get into poetry until I was in college, and I took a poetry workshop in college because I thought it would help me write better song lyrics for my punk rock band that I was playing in. So yeah, I was the front man, played guitar for lots of bands, and I played, there was one band that, I mean, we toured the States and we toured Europe over and over again, we had videos on MTV, it was, you know, I got to do all that, which was freaking awesome. So yeah, I have written songs. Writing songs and writing poems is totally different for me. So, you know, the part of the reason, and I'll tell you about how I came to poetry, but part of the reason I love poetry so much is because it is the words and the music in the very same breath. You don't need amplifiers, you don't need other people, you don't need any kind of, like, outside apparatus, you only need your voice. So when I realized that that was a thing, that that could be powerful, I was just totally, totally hooked. When I write songs, I write the music first. And I write chord beds, and then I write the melody. And then I start thinking about lyrics in relationship to the melody. So the lyrics become just another instrument. And in my lyrics, a lot more than in my poetry, I'm totally willing to let the sound guide everything. So some of the lyrics are just complete nonsense. How I came to poetry is, sorry, I told the story earlier today, but I was in that poetry workshop in college. I was a junior in college. It was a combined undergraduate and graduate poetry workshop. There were some young men in that class who had a poetry group that they called the Smaller Midwestern Poets. And they were all these sort of big, burly guys with beards. And they were older than me, and I thought they were really cool. And they put on readings around campus. And at one reading, one of these young men stood up, very blustery. He was 20 years old, and said, I've decided I'm never going to read any of my own poems in public anymore. Tonight I'm going to read two poems by Etheridge Knight. This poem's called Feeling Fucked Up. And then he launches into this poem, which is a litany of FUs to the alligators and trees and the sky and the grass and birds and Mao and Nixon and Nkrumah and you know, all the disciples, and, I mean, it's, like, crazy. And when I heard that, I was like, wow, that's a poem? Like, that's, like, I recognize that. There's something about that, about stomping around, about the violence of that, about the muscularity of that, about the explosive expression that was, and it's very musical. It said, he says, Lord, she's gone, done left, done packed up and split, and I with no way to make her come back. Bright, bone white, crystal sand glistens, dope, death, dead, dying, and jiving, drove her away, made her take her laughter and her softness and her midnight sighs. You just hear the music, and it's like, whoa! And so
after hearing that, and I didn't realize at the time it was a prayer, Lord, she's gone, done left. But the next day, I sat down for the first time and tried to write a poem without a prompt. And I've done that pretty much every day since then. And that was how I, that's what hooked me. That was the moment. And then later, one of those guys, one of the smaller Western poet guys, gave me a copy of The Essential Average Night, which I still love. And that's amazing. That's actually a really amazing poem. If you haven't read it, check it out.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all for coming. Come on up and check out the broadsides, check out the books, check out the sermon and the accompanying poems. Thank you all so much for coming tonight and all semester. It has been such a treat to see some familiar faces coming back again and again, and we will have a wild lineup again next semester, so stay tuned in your inboxes for more confusing emails from me. Thank you so much.